Hello and welcome to another episode of Thoughts on Education, an initiative by College Duniya where we interview esteemed dignitaries of notable institutes from all across India to talk to us about their experiences and expertise in the education domain. Today we have with us Ms. Rupali Gupte to share her thoughts with us. Welcome, ma'am.
Hello.
I would like to begin the session by enlightening our audiences with a brief introduction of yours.
Sure.
Ms. Rupali Gupte holds a master's degree in project management and a bachelor's degree in architecture. Currently, she is pursuing her last year of PhD in architecture education. She has 25 years of work experience in the field of architecture and 15 years in the academic domain. Her research papers on education and teaching pedagogy are published in national and international journals. Presently holding a responsible position as the principal of Srimati K.L. Tiwari College of Architecture, Mumbai, she strongly indulges in enhancing the capacities and capabilities of young minds through innovative, holistic education. We're really happy to have you with us today, ma'am.
Thank you so much, Daru. Thank you so much for welcoming, and thank you so much for a very, very warm, heartfelt words that you spoke for me. Thanks a lot. It's my privilege, definitely.
So, ma'am, beginning with the interview, my first question for the day is that you have held key positions at the education institutes throughout your professional career. What keeps you connected with the education sector, and how has your experience been so far with the institute?
The fact is over here that when you are heading an educational institute, it becomes very, very important to have a transparency, to have a freedom of from the management, to give a complete freedom to do whatever you want, to innovate, to be free in giving a platform for the young minds to explore. And I suppose this institution has done that, because architecture is a multi-dimensional career. It has varied subjects in it, and until and unless we don't give them a platform to explore, to travel, to innovate, to have n number of activities and meet people, it becomes a very what you call enclosed sort of a course. So this the education field needs to be improving day by day, to change with how the market and industry is moving around. And if the management supports you with this, it is a wonderful platform for the young minds to be prepared. And I suppose Tiwari College of Architecture with the trust has given this platform very free-handedly. In fact, to talk something about the trust is Rahul Education Banner handles the entire higher educational unit of Srimati of Tiwari College of Architecture, and they have 52 institutions. They have 5 trusts. Our Honorable Chairman Sir Shri Lalan Tiwari ji began the first school in 1992, and from there on they have 52 institutions with around 25,000 plus students, both in school, higher secondary, as well as higher educational institutions. So we are the 4-year-old baby, the architecture college, under this huge banner. They are spread all across Palghar, Mumbai, as well as Chandauli district of Uttar Pradesh. And we have begun our journey under them, and it is an amazing venture, I must say.
Sure, ma'am. That was really great to hear about the entire group of Rahul Education from you. Now, moving on to my next question. Being the principal of Srimati K.L. Tiwari College of Architecture, what are your roles and responsibilities towards the students?
Oh, that's a very interesting question, Charu. I must say that being the principal of an architecture college, you have to be very focused with the academics, because as I said, it is a multi-dimensional course, so you have n number of career opportunities, and you should enhance the student to introduce him to all these career opportunities. It's a huge 5-year long course after 12th standard. I suppose you must be aware that there are only 3 professional courses. We have architecture, we have medical, and we have law. These are the 3 professional courses which are legally professional. Rest all are specialist courses. So all other courses tell you about one specific specialty, one service which you master in. But these courses, these professional courses, are a bundle of many courses together. And the responsibility of the institute, of the head, is to see that this entire bundle is very passionately provided to students. Because it shouldn't be a burden. This has a humongous course curriculum. And if it is not blended actively with other activities, it might become too stressful for students. So it is a very, very challenging role, where all these amalgamated, varied divisions of curriculum have to be taught to the students. To name a few, I would say, if you go in for digital architecture, if you go for landscape architecture, urban housing, you go for town planning, you go for set designing, you go for product designing, you go for interior designing, all are subjects of the architecture course. And in the 5 years, the student learns all this, and by the end of the 5th year, he makes a decision that what is it that he has to do his master's in, or where he has to pursue his career doing what specific course of design. So it becomes a very huge responsibility to see that each and every course is taught well and is accepted by the student very well.
Right.
Yeah.
That's great to know, ma'am. Moving on to my next question, how do you strategize about the key programs and plans for the marketing and administration of your institute?
Well, I am an educationist, and I would not look education for marketing, basically, because it is something which is a very human and very close to the heart profession. We always say architecture is a social service that we do. So as medical is a social service, as law is a social service, it is something which deals with the human lives. And we are building for the humans. And so it is something which has to be, which has to be absorbed. The minute you are giving a holistic education, and the minute you are giving a holistic course curriculum, it is very easily expressed and proved by the students of our college. So you don't need something which is, you need to, tell them that we are going to do this. Our students itself stand out. For example, we are in our 5th year now, from where our college has started. And in the university, out of the 40 batch of students, we had 97% of first classes. Now, I am also not a follower of marks and how a grading system should be done. But believe me, when the student enjoys what he is doing, we don't have to really force him or have certain extra tuitions and classes to see to it that the course is learned. It is so much of an hands-on activity in as our philosophy, that the child enjoys doing it. And this is our main aim. If the student is happy, naturally the marketing will be through the student. It is through these students who come out and talk about. And as you said about what is the academic role, so we are into experiential learning. Experiential learning is learning by doing. So every college has its own philosophy. Every college has a way in which the entire 5-year course is taken ahead. And I personally believe in experiential learning, wherein if I'm learning something, if I'm learning a tool, I should experience it. I should do it by my hand and understand. Because when you are working on it, you realize that, yes, you realize the other nitty-gritties of it. It is not only theoretical. So majorly our subjects are hands-on activities. And we have lots of workshops which are amalgamated together. We have workshops in-house. We go out, we go to the communities and we help them out with the construction. Now, all this construction that happens is a part of subject of construction that we teach. So because of this experiential learning, there is a holistic, educational takeaway that the student learns, which is very, very important for me. And through this, they fall in love with the subject and they carry it ahead. So I think that aspect of experiential learning has benefited the students amazingly in all these 4 years of our
project. Sure, ma'am. I'm sure that the experiential learning is a facet to the curriculum that the students must be exploring in a completely innovative manner through your institute, and must be really beneficial for them, as it's also required to just give a holistic approach to the entire academies. So, exactly. Ma'am, moving on to the next question. Do you have any extracurricular activities or programs to enhance the skills of the students or expose them to real-world challenges?
Yeah. So that's what, as I said, that since we are into experiential learning, we have lot of extracurricular activities. So when we say extracurricular activities, I'm not counting the annuals, the sports, the college exhibitions. That are obviously there. What extracurricular activities we do are we have all sorts of subject learning, skill-based learning workshops. And through that, I have, even when our students travel for tours, national and international tours are a very, base, which every college follows, and it is a part of the curriculum. So what we do is, we have associated with certain firms and NGOs which are spread all over India. So all our national tours that happen, that are amalgamated with a 3 to 4 day workshop and then a 2 to 3 days of self. So normally it's a 7 to 8 days or maximum 10 days of a tour that goes. But there also there is a learning that happens with the institutes that are over there, with the organizations that are there. So there is a 3-4 day workshop, they gather certificates and they come back. Again, we are not focusing on certificates as such, but somewhere eventually when they move ahead in their future career for doing their masters, all these things matter a lot. Because as I said, it is more of a social service. It is something which the students have to understand when they go into different parts of India or different parts of the world, that how is the society forming around them? How is the architecture over there looked at? How is the traditional architecture, the modern architecture? So we have activities which blend both the ends together. I strongly believe that we have to know the roots, only then we can reach to maximum heights. So if we say that we are only looking at high-end technology, I don't think you will be able to give justice to that high-end technology if you don't know what your roots are. So there are certain very intense programs that we have with rural settlements. We have it understanding the vernacular innovative courses, vernacular innovations, the traditional techniques. And then as the child moves ahead in his third year, fourth year, as they get introduced in the syllabus for the high-end technology, that is where they get introduced to the technology, high-end technology, high-rise courses. So we have firms and teams which are collaborating with us, who are taking the students with them and teaching them practical knowledge about the community, about how things are done over there. So we also have a publication team. Our one batch has done a vernacular innovations ebook with that team, which has where they have just found out all different techniques of traditional architecture that are prevailing and that are still being done, and how sustainable and how environment friendly they are. So they have gathered all the knowledge, they have documented everything, and they are preparing a book. So this was a part of their study, of their subject, which they have practically innovated or found out, documented. They learn research to this. We have a research cell already. Our 2 to 3 students have presented research papers in national and international conferences. So what happens is this makes them inquisitive. This makes them to know more, and the whole what you call the puzzle falls in place. For international what you call tie-ups also, we have at SAB University in Barcelona, we have NUS National University of Singapore, and we have Dubai. We have these courses which when the students go there, they have the workshops. We had a six-day workshop in Barcelona, where the entire city of Barcelona was explained.
All right, ma'am. Well, my next question is that how do you try to bring in practical approach towards subjects and make them industry oriented?
So what we have done, Charu, is we have, as you said, we are into experiential learning. We have as I've also said, that we have tied up with the firms. So we have started with internships right from their second year onwards. Now, these internships are not as the real internship term means. It is more like an introduction, or we can say an incidental, introduction to the different firms. So from the second year vacation itself, our students in a group of 8 to 10, and for a minimum a week or maximum to 2 weeks, they work with the firms that we have collaborated with. So we have firms that look into architectural journalism, that look into art history, that look into cultural aspect, that look into research, that look into urbanism, that look into traditional architecture, so that look into urban architecture. Now what happens is, if I give you an example, in my second year vacation, a group of students had worked with the People Place project. This is the firm that we have collaborated with, and People Place project had further collaborated with MMRDA to make a heritage book.
So ma'am, my next question is, how do you bring in practical approach towards subjects and make them industry oriented?
Okay, so for this question, Charu, I would like to say that, as I had told, we are looking into experiential learning, and we have so many activities, formulated because of this philosophy of our college. We have started what you can call an activity, which is called as an incidental introduction activity. It's like a small internship that the student has to go through right from their second year onwards. So what happens is, in the second year, when the student gets involved with firms and he or she starts learning about how the firm works, they get more and more mature and confident over how the work is going to be. Now, these internships are very short, of maybe a week or maximum 2 weeks. These internships are specially worked out with the collaborative firms that we have collaboration with. To give you an example, we had collaborated with People Place Project. This is a firm which talks about the community and the social aspects, and does a rigorous writing work and research work. And People Place Project had collaborated with MMRDA, and they were on a project of making a heritage book. This was a book which will act as a guide for everyone to understand the fort area of Mumbai. And for making that book, our 12 students from my second year batch were working with this team of People Place Project. And they did sketches, they did research on fort area of Mumbai, they photographed. And the entire book has their sketches and their additions to it, and a very good thanksgiving given by the collaborative MMRDA and People Place Project to the college students. And the book was inaugurated during the Kala Ghoda Festival on 2nd of Feb last year. So what happens is, because of this, they get aware. Now, there is art history. We are learning history in subjects. We are learning about the heritage structures. But when there is an active participation, through internships and through real firms who are working in these areas, then the enhancement of the knowledge multiplies. It goes in multifolds. And you don't know when the student will decide that, yes, this is the field which I have to take up and move ahead as a career. So this has given a very strong base to all our students. And as I said, we have collaborated with different varied fields of landscape architects, of urbanists, of historians, of heritage conservationists. So we have heritage conservationists who take our students to Ahmedabad, and in this small internship period they try to learn about this. So it becomes a win-win situation. My students help out the firms, and in turn they get a lot of knowledge takeaway, which is a very holistic knowledge that the firms provide them with.
All right. So, ma'am, the next question is that how do you help your students to cope up with the competition being so high in the outside world?
Yeah, very, very well put question, Charu. I think if you see today's the overall situation of pandemic and overall online process that is happening, and the way students, as it is, the curriculum is very, very rigorous. And, this is a curriculum which they are not aware of. This is not theoretical knowledge. We don't have subject books that are there in architectural curriculum. So there are various books through which the curriculum has to be found out by the student. They have to research through it. Now what happens is, my very strong experience I would love to share with you is that it becomes very strong when the student gets responsible on his own. Majorly all our students participate in all the activities that the college handles. Since all the subjects are more hands-on oriented, more experiential learning oriented, do-by-hand oriented, they have to participate. They have to take the leadership. They have to do a team effort. They have to talk to their experts, not only their college mentors. They have to arrange the programs. And then it becomes their work. So the interesting part is, if I tell a younger student that this is what you have to do, he might do it 50%. Yes, so we discipline him, we focus him, we scold him, and we see to it that he does it. But the minute he feels it is my work, or mujhe wo karna hai, I have to do it, then I don't think you will have to pester him to see that, because he takes the responsibility, he owns it. So our entire family of architecture, you will see that everybody is busy with everything. And since it is a small family of just 40 intake per batch, everybody has to take up the role. So when there is a batch of 8 to 10 students going to a firm, knowing the subject, doing practical aspects of the subject, naturally they have to own it up. And this builds the responsibility in them. Of course, we have all administrative lookouts of having them their attendance, their marking sent to the parents, and then getting the monthly attendance and marking. But I suppose once it is a student's responsibility, we don't have to look back. I should say that I have always been telling the parents that until and unless there is no call coming from me to you that there is some problem with your child, don't worry. The child is with us now. So what happens is, in that, it becomes the owning of the student, and they work wonders with their enthusiasm and their potential. These youngsters have amazing potential to handle the work, which neither me or my team would have possibly been able to do it. So it just works both ways.
How does the institute enhance the skills of the faculty and prepare them according to the industry standards?
Yes. We have quality improvement programs. Even the Council of Architecture has programs which are done for the faculty. Those are called as the faculty improvement programs. They have training programs. So the faculties are constantly involved over there. And Charu, as it is an experiential learning, there is a lot of research that needs to be done before sending the students to gain that experience. So though our subject syllabus is ready, what has to be taught, but when they are going into experiential thing, the faculty have to collaborate. There is a quality improvement program wherein the firms from different fields and the faculties together work out how this thing should go ahead with, and it is conducted. For example, the team of Design Jatra, who are the national award winners for new sustainable and community-based architecture, they have been involving with our students and faculties to work out programs. Students have been going with them through their firm, then working in holidays naturally, because otherwise when you have experiential learning, you need to utilize these small transition periods where the students move out and work with other firms. But once they enjoy the work, I mean, they are just looking out for things that should happen. You know, in case we are lagging somewhere, and when we are not having the activity, there are the students who come and ask that, ma'am, when is the next activity that is proposed? We are looking for it. So these quality improvement programs are constantly happening in the institute with respect to the faculties.
Sure. Ma'am, moving on to my next question, what do you see as the greatest strength of Srimati K.L. Tiwari College of Architecture?
Greatest?
Strength.
Strength. I would say, this goes a little bit into administration, but when you're seeing that Srimati K.L. Tiwari College of Architecture, it not only involves my academics and staff, but it also involves my management. And I must say the strongest strength here is the open door policy. This open door policy is a policy wherein every staff, every student can come walk up to my cabin anytime. Though there is a strong hierarchy of how they have to approach, but you are just available to the students and to solve their queries or happinesses and whatever they want to discuss with anytime. Same is with our management. Our students can approach the management, our students can approach the highest level of the management anytime. I suppose this transparency brings in a very strong confidence amongst everyone. So there is not something wherein we don't know, we were not aware, why is this happening? You can question why is this happening, and we are here to answer you. And you have to be satisfied and contented with the answer that we are giving you. Otherwise, we are ready to change and work out towards the better solution. I suppose this is a very strong strength of the trust of the college. The freedom that the management gives the principal, and the freedom that the principal gives the staff, because it is, you know, how the culture just percolates. The minute you see your higher authority is doing that, you eventually are supposed, you just do that, you see the things happening. And when these things fall in place, I suppose it just gives a very robust picture to the entire institution. And I suppose that is the strongest strength of our management, of our college. That is why we can explore so much. That is why we have, even in the 5 years, we have so many collaborations, and we have so many resources, and we have so many tie-ups also. Because that were the need of the students, and they have put it up, and we have put it up, and it just worked. So I think that is the biggest strength that Tiwari College has.
What are some of the biggest challenges that you see, both for higher education in general and for Srimati K.L. Tiwari College of Architecture specifically?
There are challenges in terms of, I would say this is a combined challenge for educative field and Tiwari College of Architecture, is to see to it that each student is self-aware with what he or she wants to do and pursue his or her career in. As I said, architecture is a multidimensional course So naturally what happens is when you, if in the end of 5 years this child is still worried about ab main kya karu, what is gaining me more benefit and which course I should take as master's, then there is a big question on what we have done for the 5 years. In the 5 years, the entire philosophy of education talks about that the student should know his or her capacities. He might be good in one or two, he might be excellent in one or two subjects. Not necessarily he has to be good in all the subjects. But architecture profession provides that career in that subject which he is so good at. And to find out, to give the student that platform to explore that subject, to understand whether that subject is really my passionate subject, is the biggest challenge. So this challenge, if you see, we would not say whether our students are ready for the market. You know, it is whether the market, you know, is wanting the right students, is getting the right students from my institution. So if there is somebody who is very good with landscape and he has found out his passion, if he gets certain you know, incidents where he can work with these, and if he follows the landscape architecture industry, I suppose he will add humongously and he will do total justice to that field of architecture. So grooming them to find their own path, grooming them to find their own focused field in which they can excel, is the biggest challenge. And I suppose we love doing this challenge, because if you see today, if you see the pandemic, if you see the overall situation, there is a big question mark for the entire possibility of career opportunities that are present in the market today. But if you know what is your passion, if you follow your passion, you will create a niche for yourself. You don't have to go searching for opportunities. The opportunity will come to you on itself because you know what you want to do. And that is the biggest challenge, to groom the child to see to it that he reaches his destination, the right destination that is made for him.
Right. And that brings me to my last question for the day. Any suggestions that you would like to give to the current youth and aspiring students?
Yes, my sincere advice to you is that follow your heart, follow what you love. Please don't run after the superficial, what you call glamorous or money-minded approach that you see in the market. Don't try to find careers which you say ki are ye karke ise itna abhi, now he's earning so much and he's earning so much, so I should also do that. No, just follow your passion. Find out what is it that you love doing. Believe me, all other luxuries, all other glamour will follow. You just have to focus on your passionate fields. And I suppose architecture is the platform where your hobbies, your passions can be amalgamated. It is a huge, as I said, bunch of varied fields of arts, architecture, sculpture, painting, music, technicalities of design, of space management. It is a huge amalgamation. And I suppose if you can find your passion, if you can find the career that you feel you can do wonders with, which you love, then please don't look at what the career would give you. If you are giving your 100% passionately to the work that you are doing, the universe will give you in multifolds. So follow your passion is the only motto that I have to tell these younger generation of today.
Thank you so much, ma'am. This was really an insightful session. Thank you for giving us your time and speaking to us amidst your busy schedule. And we look forward to interacting with you again very soon. Thanks a lot.
Definitely, Charu. Thank you so much to College Dunia, and thank you so much to your entire team for creating this platform. I'm sure that this is something which is going to help the students immensely, and I wish you all the very, very best in all your future MBBS. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.